How do the past's greatest structures measure up in the 21st century? In this series, we're going to use the most advanced technology on the planet to put history's building wonders to the test. Famous structures around the world, pored over for centuries by archaeologists and historians, we've never truly been able to uncover all of their secrets. But now, scientific breakthroughs have created an amazing new laser technology that can capture and explore these structures in a way no human eye can. For the first time, allowing us to understand some of the oldest mysteries of the engineering world.
Believe nothing. Don't believe your eyes. Believe this.
This time, the time scanners are in London to discover the incredible building legacy of St. Paul's Cathedral. From its world-famous majestic dome to the scars of history that give us an insight into its turbulent past. With our laser technology, we're going to reveal just how good yesterday's engineers really are. London, Britain's capital and home to some of the world's greatest buildings, including an architectural jewel that has shone in the heart of the city for over 300 years. Welcome to London and welcome to St. Paul's Cathedral, the vision of one man. Built by renowned architect Sir Christopher Wren, this masterpiece of Renaissance architecture was a wonder of the age. A landmark in the evolution of structural engineering, this grand place of worship continues to astound today. It's a symbol of the British nation, magnificently wrought in stone. The walls of this awe-inspiring cathedral contain many engineering secrets, and we have a unique way to discover and decode them. Recent scientific breakthroughs mean we now have a device portable enough to travel the world and access these incredible places, and powerful enough to explore deep inside their structural secrets. The mobile laser scanner. These bounce narrow pulses of light off objects to map them with incredible accuracy. What's packed into this tiny box gives our experts virtual superpowers. Collecting over a billion measurements to form what is known as a point cloud, giving us an incredible 3D perspective, the ability to pick up million-ton structures and move them anywhere, and use this data to take precise measurements with pinpoint accuracy, to peel back time and help us unravel mysteries locked in the past. But the real key to the technology is in the interpretation of this data. And we're seeing it through the eyes of one of the world's best structural engineers, Steve Burrows. A master of the modern building world, Steve has created such iconic structures as the Beijing Bird's Nest Stadium, Munich's Allianz Arena, and Manchester's Etihad Stadium.
I travel around the world, been involved in the design of amazing buildings. But when I come to St. Paul's Cathedral, I realize that right at home, right here, on home ground, we have one of the best iconic buildings on the entire planet.
Steve has always wanted to explore the great building mysteries of the past, and now he has the technology to do it. To aid his mission, he's brought a team from one of the world's best research centers. Caitlin Stevens, Adam Barnes, and Katie Simon, all from the Center for Advanced Spatial Technologies at the University of Arkansas. Steve wants to discover the secrets of this cathedral's construction and get into the mind of Sir Christopher Wren, the visionary genius who designed and built it.
There is nothing in this country or anywhere in the world that can match what Wren has actually delivered here.
Steve will take full advantage of our scanner's capabilities to analyze St. Paul's like never before.
And what we're going to do is take the laser scanning technology and then strip away all the decoration and get to the fundamentals of how this building really works. unwrap the building, basically get back to the bones.
Scanning St. Paul's is a real challenge. The team will have to work around the thousands of tourists who visit here every day and navigate the labyrinthine passages, tunnels and staircases that run like a rabbit warren through its walls.
The main problems we've had so far are communicating where we are at certain times. So it's like a big maze that we've never been through before, and we're just figuring our way through.
The team has risen to the challenge, and these initial scans of St. Paul's are complete. They should give us an overview of the building, and it's time to reveal them in our tech HQ.
Oh, wow, look at that. Fantastic. That is absolutely fantastic.
How many points in that, Caitlin?
On the exterior, we have about 500 million points.
500 million?
Just look at the detail of it. You can see everything, like every column, every bit of decoration.
Steve's using these initial scans to target specific areas that he wants to explore further.
The thing that sort of strikes me is to try and get under the skin, because this building's completely different on the inside than it is on the outside.
Yeah.
Steve wants to use the scans to understand the complex internal structure of the cathedral's vast dome, to unearth how Wren overcame unstable foundations to elevate it high above the city, using architectural tricks to hide his engineering, and reveal how the cathedral withstood a direct hit from a German bomb during World War II. Steve's first target is the crowning glory of St. Paul's, the dome. Towering more than 110 meters above London, it weighs in at around 65,000 tons. That's the same as an aircraft carrier. The dome also carries the weight of the stone lantern at the very top. At around 700 tons, it's a building in itself, the equivalent weight of four houses stacked on top of each other. The key to how the gargantuan dome supports the heavy weight of the lantern is hidden deep inside its structure.
What I want to discover is how the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral actually works. What is it like inside the dome? How does the whole thing actually fit together? What is the structural engineering behind the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral?
Steve has climbed up to the highest point of the dome, the inside of the lantern.
As a structural engineer, I get really excited about spaces like this. People all over London look at St. Paul's Cathedral and see this enormous lantern right up there in the sky. You've got to realize how high in the air we actually are. This point here, 700 tons of lantern sit on two layers of brickwork. What we've got here are the biggest forces in the entire cathedral. Those forces travel huge distances before they get down to the foundation. And if I just look down this hole here, I can see right down to the cathedral floor. If you actually get this wrong, you've got 700 tons of material traveling 250 feet right down to the floor.
St. Paul's Dome is among the largest in Northern Europe. Wren was inspired by new architectural trends, and designing St. Paul's with a dome was a break from the traditional spires of medieval Gothic cathedrals.
Why do you think Wren wanted to do domes rather than the traditional spire?
I think the idea is to create this very large space inside that isn't full of columns. So when you think about volume, the best way to cover a large volume is a dome. That's a very efficient system. You could create this enormous space, you know, this sort of heavenly space. I'm pretty sure he liked the idea of reaching for the heavens.
Building a dome that could support the 700-ton lantern and its 7-meter-tall cross was something that no engineer had ever attempted.
It's very difficult because it's only really stable once the final piece is in place. I mean, it either stands up or crashes to the ground, so you get one chance to get it right.
And Wren succeeded with style.
It's absolutely magnificent, completely breathtaking. But strangely, that dome isn't the same dome that you see from the outside. The whole thing is an optical illusion that hides many secrets, and we want to find out just how Wren did it.
Steve has asked the team to climb to the top of St. Paul's. This is the first time that the dome's internal spaces have ever been scanned. And the team is encountering cramped areas filled with complicated structures.
To connect this scan to that scan in this narrow cavity is tricky.
Steve's now going to take me up for a vertigo-inducing closer look. Up here, we're in the heart of an optical illusion. While this area looks dome-shaped from below, we're actually in a structure shaped more like a huge traffic cone that funnels up to the lantern above us.
It's an amazing space. It sort of plays tricks on your mind, really.
The stones of its walls are another illusion. These blocks have been painted on to deceive the eye. With our technology, we're about to strip away this groundbreaking dome to reveal a masterpiece of deception. The hidden engineering of St. Paul's Cathedral is about to be uncovered in our tech HQ.
When you look at the dome from the outside, you see this massive load that's applied at the top.
Yeah.
So the question for me is, how does the force get from here down to the foundations?
So this scan, as it is, it's showing us this beautiful image of St. Paul's from the outside.
Yes.
But it's really the inside we want to find out about, isn't it? We want to get under its skin.
Caitlin, could we turn on the structural forms inside the dome, please?
Sure.
Now the scans will help us see what Wren was trying to hide.
Yeah.
So here's the interior.
Oh, brilliant, brilliant, excellent. What we've got is the outside shown here and the inside shown here.
And then here's the actual cone.
Oh, that's perfect if you leave it like that. So what we can see here, this is the brick cone that actually supports all of that weight. That gets it down to this level here. What everybody sees on the skyline of London is this dome, which is simply propped off the brick cone using big pieces of wood.
It's designed to make the London skyline impressive.
Yeah. And in between, there's the muscle.
With our technology, we can take apart St. Paul's dome to show the hidden structure inside. And this is the cone that's holding up the vast weight of the stone lantern above. When we remove this cone, we see the inner ceiling that tricks your eye when looking up from below.
So this is the hidden secret. This is the structure that's hidden inside St. Paul's Cathedral to get the loads from the top down to the bottom.
Yeah.
We can see the decorative dome on the outside, and we can see the decorative ceiling on the inside, but hidden between the two is this structural cone of brick.
It is the perfect solution, even though it is hidden from the world.
Yeah, he's like the master of structural disguise.
Using the scan data, we can move through the cone structure into the space behind. And Steve is taking me into this area to see it up close.
Wow, this is where you really start to understand the domes, isn't it? So this is the skin of the outer dome.
Yep, that's the fresh air outside that.
Wow, what a space.
Well, this is what we're here for.
Yeah.
This over here.
Yeah.
This is the structure that holds up the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral.
So up there, the huge lantern is actually sitting on this. This is the thing that holds it up.
And this brickwork. And this brickwork goes all the way. All the way. Down there. That's got to be 70, 80 feet below us.
Yeah.
All in brickwork.
The giant cone is made of bricks just two layers thick, an heroic feat of construction.
What we've got is sort of three layers of the dome. So this exterior roof, which we can see here, is the outer one. Then this cone here is the one that carries all the structural loads. And then inside is the ceiling
And that's what Renner's done to hold up the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral.
Building a groundbreaking dome wasn't Wren's only engineering challenge. In many ways, the whole cathedral was an experiment, pushing the limits of technology and the boundaries of the possible.
When you walk in here, it sends shivers down your spine. It's not just the size of it and the scale and the significance, but it's also the proportions. It just feels right as a space.
But beneath the surface of this Renaissance marvel lies a secret.
In the process of building this cathedral, Wren came up against a huge problem. The whole place was sinking.
When the construction of the cathedral began in 1675, Wren had to decide what material to build his foundations on. And the consequence of this critical decision is the focus of Steve's next investigation.
On the one hand, he could have chosen sand. Very loose material. Imagine he thought this was like sand on the beach, and if you put a load on it, it would simply move sideways. Instead, he chose this, a clay material. It feels much stronger than the sand. This just runs through my fingers. But what actually happened was when the cathedral loads were applied, they behaved very differently. So this is what would have happened if Wren had built St. Paul's Cathedral on sand. If I remove it, you can see the depth that it went down. It's almost nothing. By comparison, St. Paul's Cathedral was built on clay, and this is what has happened. The load, just being applied exactly the same, starts to settle into the ground, and you can see it just goes further and further over time.
Wren's decision to build St. Paul's on clay meant that the cathedral's foundations began to subside, and the ground beneath gave way as construction progressed. The scanning team are beginning their hunt for signs of this movement. Steve has joined Caitlin outside. He wants to know if our technology can detect subsidence on the exterior of the cathedral. He needs a series of precise measurements, something our scanning technology excels at.
I'm really interested in the level around some key points on the cathedral. So I'd like to pick something like the level on that outer corner of facade, and then pick some relevant points that are equal on other locations.
As Caitlin begins collecting data, Steve explores the crypt beneath the cathedral floor to see some evidence of subsidence firsthand.
By looking at a level across the wall here, I can see just how far out this masonry is. I lift the level up until it shows perfect, and it's about there. So just in this length of wall, about 6 feet long, it's an inch out of level.
As the walls of St. Paul's grew in height, Wren was faced with clear evidence of his flawed decision to build the cathedral on London clay. Cracks were beginning to appear in his stones.
Hey, look at this, Dallas.
Wow, God, I didn't realize it was that bad.
Here
That's
it is.
Really, really pronounced, isn't it?
A big crack right through the wall. And these joints, see the repair in here? These blocks would have moved relative to each other. This one stayed up in the air. This one went down. Big crack came, and you can see how it's come right through here.
So he knew when he was building this church that he had a big problem.
He did. It would have happened almost immediately, even in the first few months.
If you look on the other side, you can see it even more pronounced. The bottom of the window there, is that's a heck of an angle, isn't it?
Choosing the wrong material to build on was Wren's greatest mistake. The foundations of his cathedral were moving as they settled into the soft clay beneath. Wren's cathedral was at risk of failing before it had even been finished. And even his great dome was under threat.
There are huge forces imposed by the dome right down the center of the building. We might very well find that the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral isn't vertical. It could be the Leaning Tower of St. Paul's. Maybe the circle isn't a complete circle any longer. I want to understand exactly how much it's moved.
Steve has now sent the scanners up to record the dome's precise dimensions and geometry. If the dome is leaning, they will be able to detect it.
He made mistakes in building this building. Everybody does when you build an iconic building, and they're there to be seen today. So I want to understand some of those mistakes, find out what I can learn from them.
With his cathedral sinking and his dome at risk of leaning, Wren faced a real battle. But did he emerge victorious? In Tech HQ, Steve hopes to expose the secrets of the stones.
Can we work out the extent of the problem? I want to know how bad it is. That's what I want to find out.
Steve is using this digital horizontal line as a giant spirit level to compare it to the architectural details on the facade of the building.
So we've got this perfect level line here.
Yep.
And then we've picked a series of points on the perimeter, and we've measured the distance from our perfect line to those points. So here we go. Here are four measurements. So 15.153.
Yes.
15.224. 15.159 and 15.203. Sorry. Biggest difference we've got is 3 inches in the entire length of the facade of St. Paul's Cathedral, which is nothing. It's almost perfect.
A difference of just 3 inches or 7.5 centimeters shows that against all the odds, Wren managed to overcome the subsidence. He must have flattened out the sagging in his foundations and lower walls by correcting and adjusting each course of stonework as the cathedral was being built. And over time, the building stopped sinking into the clay. By the time Wren had built to the top of the main body of the cathedral, he'd made it almost completely level. But was Wren as successful with his dome? It's now time to discover whether our scanning team has been able to detect any movement in the dome itself. And the scan data yields a surprise that might make the task easier.
See these things here?
The chandeliers.
The chandeliers actually act like plumbobs.
A plumbob is simply a weight on a piece of string. It's used by builders to see how vertical or plumb a structure is. Because the chandeliers hang perfectly vertically, Steve can compare them to the angle of the dome.
And so when we did the scanning, we realized that we could utilize these to figure out how plumb is the dome of St. Paul's Cathedral.
And?
Caitlin, can we turn on the vertical?
I hadn't even thought of that. Can we work out what sort of angle it's at?
We can.
The Leaning Dome of London.
This purple line shows the angle of the dome. The red line marks the chandelier, which we know hangs vertically. And the data reveals that the two are completely parallel.
So what has happened here is that Wren got to this position in construction.
Yeah.
Things were settling. But basically, during the period of building the actual dome, he fixed it all. He made everything perfectly level. Yeah. And what we've got is not the Leaning Dome of St. Paul's. We've got a perfect building.
Perfectly, perfectly vertical.
Absolutely perfect.
That's amazing. That's amazing. It's exactly the opposite of what I thought.
What we often say is that, you know, doctors bury their mistakes, but architects and engineers have to live with them. And Wren made some mistakes, like the ground conditions mistake. And yet, he worked and he made it better and better until the final product is just perfect.
So, despite unstable foundations, Wren prevailed. St. Paul's is almost perfectly level on the outside, and the dome does not lean. Wren's cathedral isn't the first St. Paul's to stand on this site. A medieval Gothic cathedral stood here for almost 600 years. But Wren was given the opportunity to build his grand new vision by a truly catastrophic event. Early one morning in 1666.
A fire broke out in a bakery on this very street, Pudding Lane.
Raging for 4 days, the great fire ripped the heart out of the old city.
Hundreds of acres of London were decimated. 13,200 homes were burnt to the ground, as well as the great cathedral of St. Paul's.
With the old cathedral in ruins, Wren was asked to begin designing a replacement. And it took a special sort of person to pull off the epic feat of taking the design from the drawing board through to completion. Sir Christopher Wren was a man of many talents, a true genius.
What's remarkable is that Wren wasn't even a trained architect, at least not in the modern sense of the word. He was actually an astronomer and a mathematician. So as much as St. Paul's Cathedral is a monument to faith, it's also a monument to science.
Steve has revealed how the great scientist and mathematician triumphed over London's unstable geology, and he'll soon shed light on how Wren played an engineering ace to thrust his great dome high into the sky. Our scans of St. Paul's are opening a doorway into its architect's mind. The secrets of Christopher Wren's genius lie in these walls. Steve Burrows believes he's discovered one of those secrets and thinks that our scanning will be able to unmask it.
So standing here on the cathedral floor, I'm wondering how do the tons of dome that Wren has built right up there in the air get transmitted right down to the foundations below? And I think I've found the secret. When I look around, I can see these arches with massive loads on. But one thing's particularly caught my eye, and that is the arch up there. What I can see is the arch below has actually got no load on it, so it must be false. And the one above has got walls that cut through the side. I think what I'm looking at are actually hidden columns.
So despite appearances, Steve thinks that the false arches and columns we can see are purely decorative and play no structural role. It seems that there are taller columns hidden behind them that are actually supporting the weight of the dome above. And Wren has left us an intriguing legacy that could shed light on this idea. We've come to see this magnificent survivor from the 17th century. It's known as the Great Model.
This isn't just probably the finest architectural model ever built. It's also a fascinating window into the mind of Christopher Wren.
This model is big enough to climb inside and get a true sense of its proportions. At 4 meters tall and 6 meters long, it took a year to build and cost a small fortune. But the Great Model is a vision for St. Paul's that was never built. There were, in fact, a number of changes made before Wren got the go-ahead. And Steve has noticed that Wren has built the model with columns that stretch from the floor all the way up to the base of the dome.
The impressive thing is the scale and the ambition of what's possible. Yeah. And it's shown so simply. You know, there are these eight columns that go around the outside supporting this huge dome. These actually carry all the thrusts off that roof back down to the ground. And there are eight of them and they're all the same.
In contrast, the columns in the actual cathedral only appear to go as high as the first arches and not up to the base of the dome. Adam is now scanning the Great Model. Steve wants to compare the columns in the Great Model to the columns Wren built in the real-life St. Paul's. He believes that this will support his idea that Wren had disguised a series of large columns that hold up the dome of St. Paul's. Steve thinks that our state-of-the-art technology will be able to give him a bit more information.
What I want to do is to take apart the intricate carvings, take apart the finishes, so that we can see right through into the bones of the structure and figure out how those loads get down to the ground.
Steve hopes the data can shed light on how Wren designed the hidden columns.
What I want to do is to actually remove the decoration and see if we can find the hidden columns that support the dome of St. Paul's. Can we do that? Can we just strip the decoration off for a moment?
Okay.
By manipulating our scan data, the hidden columns are now clear to see. Rather than reaching only part of the way up, they actually extend from the floor all the way up to the dome above.
This is the column. So we've taken that face that we could see above, matched it to below, and you can actually see that Wren has hidden behind all the decorations the eight columns that go all the way around to support the dome of St. Paul's.
Steve's gone back to the cathedral floor for a closer look.
These huge stone pillars actually comprise two different elements. This one here is the structure that holds up the roof, and this one here is just decoration.
By extending the full height from the floor to the dome, these hidden columns mirror those in Wren's model.
The clue was the Great Model. When I went inside it, I could see these huge columns that went up and held a dome.
This scan of the Great Model clearly shows the eight columns that reach from the floor to the dome. When Steve directly compares the scan of the columns in the Great Model to the scan of the columns in the real St. Paul's, Wren's engineering secrets are exposed. Steve has discovered another of his ingenious methods.
He wanted, in his own heart, to have delivered his original idea. So what Wren did was he actually copied the idea that was in the great model in the final St. Paul's Cathedral and then hid it behind some decoration.
Smoke and mirrors.
Smoke and mirrors, yeah. And also, that's the single-mindedness of the man.
We've discovered that once again, Wren had performed engineering magic to camouflage the structural secrets of St. Paul's. He had hidden the huge columns he'd originally envisioned that support his dome. In more recent times, however, this dome would face destruction in a way that Wren could never have imagined. World War II. London was being bombed by German aircraft night after night. It was known as the Blitz. As many as 30,000 people were killed, and great swathes of the city were reduced to rubble. This footage, filmed from St. Paul's, shows the cathedral surrounded by a sea of flame, what became known as the Second Great Fire of London.
So many of the buildings in this immediate vicinity were flattened by German bombs in the war, but miraculously, the cathedral survived and it became this national symbol of defiance, but it could have quite easily have been a different story.
On the night of the 17th of April, 1941, St. Paul's took a direct hit from a German high explosive bomb. It punched through the roof and blew up inside the building. Reports said that the bomb had broken through the cathedral floor and detonated in the crypt. And a photograph taken soon after shows a huge hole in the floor. Steve has noticed damage high up inside the cathedral caused by shrapnel, fragments of metal thrown out by the bomb. This damage calls into question the accounts that the bomb exploded in the crypt.
I know that St. Paul's Cathedral was bombed in the Second World War, and that one of those bombs actually went through the roof and exploded inside the building. What I want to do is to use the scans to see if I can find the exact point in space where the bomb exploded. But I also want to know, how did St. Paul's Cathedral survive this enormous blast?
The walls of the cathedral hold the clues that will allow us to discover the exact point where the bomb went off. By scanning them with millimeter accuracy, the team will be able to forensically analyze them for even the smallest traces of evidence.
What I want to do is see if I can find the shrapnel pieces from the bomb and by scanning, put together the exact location in space where the bomb went off. I think we're in for some surprises.
Steve has been joined by Oliver Caro, resident architect of St. Paul's Cathedral. He's found some important clues that could help Steve in his quest.
We've got these photographs from our archive, and you think, well, yeah, the bomb went off in the crypt.
Yeah, that would definitely be what you would first think.
But Steve thinks another scenario could be more likely.
It's possible that it could have exploded, you know, right up at the roof level at initial impact, or even hit the floor and exploded on the floor. I don't know for certain. Wherever the bomb went off, it would have sprayed shrapnel everywhere. The casing of the bomb blown into pieces and fired like bullets from wherever the bomb was in every single direction. These windows would have all been blown out, I guess.
And we do have evidence of shrapnel, actually, and I've seen it on some of the outside walls.
Evidence of shrapnel damage on outside walls is the breakthrough that Steve needs.
The shrapnel would go through the windows and penetrate into the walls. And if we reverse that, we can find actually where it came from.
That would clear up a few issues here, which have gone on for 60 years.
Oliver is taking Steve outside to another of Wren's architectural illusions. Behind the window is a false wall covered with shrapnel damage.
Oh, wow, it's absolutely incredible. Look at this.
You can almost feel the power of that, can't you?
Okay.
Just one single blow.
And something's cracked that, so it's hit it with quite a thump, hasn't it?
Oh, incredible. It's almost as though it's drawn itself on the wall. It's just like a trace of exactly what happened.
Yeah.
So we can start to see that heavy damage, you know, the line that it must have come through
The bomb must have been something like this sort of alignment, whatever that.
So this is like a great big picture frame.
It is, yeah.
Through which you're chucking bits of hot metal.
Yeah, and whatever they hit is that wall, and they just embed themselves in the wall and demonstrate where they came from.
And actually, there are some quite big, really big bits of damage quite low down, which almost suggests that the bomb had to be above.
The scanners are going to tell us for sure, but it didn't go off in the crypt. It went off in the main cathedral.
Otherwise, how could it get a piece of shrapnel down there?
Pretty high up. You know, it's got to be up. You know, the alignment is something like where my hand is from the shrapnel.
And the story might be just the same on the other side as well, so you could sort of get a fix from both sides.
That's what we're going to do. We're going to actually take both, draw all the shrapnel lines back through the window and see where they intersect, and that's the point where the bomb went off.
So Steve thinks that the shrapnel damage on the wall outside the window is clear evidence that the bomb didn't explode in the crypt, but much higher up. The only way for us to tell for certain is to send our scanners out onto the roof. If the team could prove this theory by tracing the paths of shrapnel through the window, they'll be rewriting the history of St. Paul's. It's time to see if our scans will help Steve to pinpoint the precise location of the bomb's explosion for the first time. Oliver has joined us in Tech HQ to see the results.
So when you look at the photographs of the bomb damage, there's this blooming great hole in the floor, which suggests that the bomb actually went through the floor and exploded in the crypt. But there is some debate about that, isn't there?
We're going to use our scans to turn back time, rewinding the explosion to show us precisely where it took place.
Let's focus in detail on that area. So this is the window, and we're looking at the wall beyond. So all of the shrapnel came through this window and embedded in this wall.
And you can see...
Look at that!
Yeah, every single one.
Every single bit.
See how
clear
it is?
Even the little one.
Yeah?
Yeah.
When the bomb exploded, every piece of shrapnel that hit the wall outside must have passed through the window. These lines show the range of trajectories that any one piece of shrapnel could have taken from the explosion to its impact with the wall.
This is a piece of shrapnel embedded in the wall.
Yeah.
And this is the window from which it came. So we know that the bomb was in that zone.
The shrapnel couldn't have come anywhere else except for in that space, because otherwise it couldn't have hit that point.
Correct.
So really, this is like a big game of pin the tail on the donkey, isn't it? But with a bomb.
To narrow down the location of the explosion, we now need to combine the information from a number of points of shrapnel damage. When we combine all the possible paths of the shrapnel pieces, there's only one area where the bomb could have exploded.
So where exactly did the bomb go off?
The point at which the bomb went off is right here. So very high up, about halfway up the windows, at the top of the cathedral, is where the bomb exploded.
Which says it didn't explode in the crypt.
Absolutely.
That's a really important conclusion.
And the thing is, our eyes have deceived us, because we've seen that famous photograph with a big hole.
Yes.
And by looking at that, you automatically assume the bomb must have done that hole.
It shows you can't believe
your eyes. You can't believe
what it says in the newspaper.
Exactly. Don't believe nothing. Don't believe your eyes. Believe this.
We've blown away the idea that the bomb exploded in the crypt, and our scans have proved for the first time that the German bomb in fact exploded just beneath the cathedral's ceiling. It's an important discovery. But the team are about to unearth evidence that the explosion caused far more than shrapnel damage. The trail of clues left by the dramatic bomb blast that tore through St. Paul's is leading Steve Burrows on another journey. He wants to find out about some additional damage that has only recently come to light. It was discovered by Robert Bowles when restoration was being carried out in 2004.
It was during the general cleaning of the paintings in the dome. They'd found some cracks which were clearly quite new, and I realized that actually the damage precisely matched the sort of thing that would happen from that bomb.
Robert had found a crack running like a ring around the dome's ceiling that showed the full extent of the bomb's awesome power.
It lifted, or it shuddered, this section of masonry. Because under all normal gravity forces, there'd be no reason for a crack like that to appear.
So the bomb actually came through the roof and exploded inside the cathedral, and then this massive pressure that came from the bomb actually lifted up the ceiling section.
It did indeed, and it's very fortunate that it only shuddered and didn't lift anymore, because if it had done that, it would have probably collapsed completely down onto the church floor.
St. Paul's escaped this catastrophe, and the crack has long since been repaired, but it's an important reminder of the powerful pressure wave which spread through the cathedral and pushed up the vast weight of the dome. And there are more hidden clues that reveal just how close the bomb came to destroying the dome.
Now, your theory about the bomb blast might actually explain that. What do you make of that?
Well, there's quite a bit of movement there to start with, but it looks like it's been lifted up in the air and moved sideways. It definitely goes along with the idea of a bomb blast in the air.
These few centimetres of movement are vast when we think about the colossal weight that's pressing down from above. And this isn't the only evidence of the bomb blast's devastation. Oliver has brought Steve to the roof space above the cathedral ceiling. This wall was so badly damaged by the blast, it had to be dismantled and rebuilt after the war. To reconstruct Wren's stonework accurately, each block was numbered.
It's a map. They've taken the whole wall down, numbered every stone before they did it, so that they could put them back in exactly
in
the right
perfect
sequence.
Place. Incredible.
33, 34, 35.
Steve has seen firsthand how the bomb explosion damaged the dome and buckled the very fabric of Wren's cathedral. And our scan data has a dramatic revelation.
We're actually looking at a bomb that went...
Well, that is it, isn't
it?
That's it.
That went off here.
Yeah, yeah.
The bomb went off here, and that's where the Dome of St. Paul's is. So that small distance, just the span of my fingers on this plan, is how close it was to the dome.
So 7.6 metres from the main dome.
Steve believes that if our bomb had hit the dome, it could have destroyed it.
It could have been catastrophic. Imagine the damage that would have caused by this coming down.
It brings cold sweat.
You have to put that in perspective. This bomb has been dropped from several thousand feet.
Yeah.
And has missed by 25 feet.
Oh, God.
So that is, you know, almost a dot.
It tells us just how lucky we were.
Using groundbreaking laser scanning technology, Steve and the team have lifted the lid on the Great Dome of St. Paul's to reveal the secret brick cone that supports the lantern above, established that Wren overcame sinking foundations to build an almost perfect masterpiece, exposed his hidden columns that support the dome, and for the first time, we've pinpointed the location of the wartime bomb that threatened the cathedral. By transforming ancient stones and structures into awe-inspiring digital models, Steve and the team have explored the engineering secrets of London's St. Paul's Cathedral and delved into the mind of the genius Sir Christopher Wren. Building St. Paul's was Wren's life's work. It took him 36 years. The story goes that at the age of 90, on a visit to the cathedral, he caught a chill and died a few days later.
This is the tomb of Christopher Wren. And if you're wondering why this is so plain, then you just have to look at the Latin inscription above it. If you seek his monument, then you just have to look around.